Hello students, welcome to my YouTube channel Catalyst Chemistry Classes. In today's video, I am going to discuss synopsis for the chapter Chemical Thermodynamics. So, before starting, if you are not subscribed to my channel, please do subscribe and share it to the maximum. So, what is meant by thermodynamics? It's a branch of science that describes the behavior of matter and the transformation between different forms of energy on a macroscopic scale. And thermodynamics describes a system in terms of its bulk properties. So, in this chapter, we are going to discuss some basic definitions. They are system. It's a part of universe under investigation is called system. Surrounding, anything that outside the system is called surrounding. Then there are different types of system. The first one is closed system. A system which can exchange only energy with surrounding. Open system. A system which can exchange both energy and matter with the surrounding. Isolated system. A system which cannot exchange matter or energy with surrounding. Homogeneous system. System consists of single phase. Example, pure solid, a pure liquid, a solution, or a mixture of gases. Heterogeneous system. A system consisting of many phases. Example, system of two immiscible liquids like oil in water. Two or more solids, a liquid in contact with its vapor, etc. are the examples for homogeneous system. Boundary. The interface between system and surrounding is called boundary. Across boundary, energy and mass are transferred between system and surrounding. And boundary can be real or hypothetical. Wall. A real boundary is called wall. Then, state variables or state functions. To define a thermodynamic states of a system, we have to specify the values of certain measurable quantities. These are called thermodynamic variables or state variables. A system can be completely defined by four variables, namely pressure, temperature, volume, and composition. Extensive properties that depends on quantity of matter contained in system. Example, mass, volume, heat capacity, etc. Intensive properties that depends only on nature of the substance and are independent of amount of the substance present in the system. Example, temperature, pressure, density, etc. Then, thermodynamic process. So, these are said to occur when a system changes from one state to another state. There are many different types of process like isothermal process, which occurs when temperature remains constant throughout the process. Adiabatic process, the process in which heat can not flow between system and surrounding, which means that there is no heat exchange between system and surrounding. Isochoric process, which occurs when volume of the system is kept constant. Isobaric process, which occurs when pressure of the system is kept constant. Cyclic process, the process in which a system proceeds via many intermediate steps and returns to the initial state. Change in internal energy, that is dE or dU, which is equal to zero, and change in enthalpy, that is delta H or dH, which is equal to zero. Thermodynamic quantities, in that internal energy, the energy stored within a substance is called its internal energy, and it is represented by symbol U or E. And it is the sum of all the different types of energies associated with atoms and molecules. The change in internal energy is given by delta U, which is equal to U2 minus U1. That is, internal energy at final state to that of internal energy at initial state. And internal energy is a state function and it is an extensive property. Work. There are two types of work in thermodynamics. Electrical work, which is the product of EMF and quantity of electricity. Then work, which is a difference between pressure and volume. In irreversible process, the mathematical expression for work, W, which is equal to minus P into delta V. And in isothermal reversible condition, W, which is equal to minus 2.303 nRT log V2 by V1. Or in case of pressure, W, which is equal to minus 2.303 nRT log P1 by P2. Heat. It is a mode of energy exchanged between the system and the surrounding as a result of difference of temperature between them. It is represented by symbol Q. When heat is given by the system, it is given negative sign. When heat is absorbed by the system, it is given positive sign. Work and heat are not the state functions. So here we have a sign convention. Heat is taken negative when it goes out of the system. Heat is taken positive when it comes inside the system. Here we can observe. So if heat that consists of negative sign which goes out of the system, if heat which carries positive sign which comes inside the system. Similarly, if work is done on the system, then W, or that is work, will be positive. If work is done by the system, then work is having negative value. Then, first law of thermodynamics. It is also known as law of conservation of energy. And you know that statement, like, it states that energy can neither be created nor be destroyed, although it may be converted from one form to another. Or, the energy of an isolated system is constant. And the mathematical expression is delta U, which is equal to Q plus W. Some important results. For isothermal irreversible expansion, Q equal minus W, that is equal to P into V2 minus V1. For isothermal reversible expansion or compression from volume V1 to V2, Q, which is equal to minus W, which is equal to nRT ln V2 by V1. For isothermal expansion of an ideal gas against vacuum, that is for free expansion, delta U equal to zero, W equal to zero, Q equal to zero. Since internal energy of an ideal gas is a function of temperature, for all isothermal process involving ideal gas, delta U equal to zero, whether the process is reversible or irreversible. For adiabatic change, Q equals zero, therefore delta U, which is equal to W. For isochoric process, W equal to zero, therefore delta U, which is equal to QV plus zero. That is, heat given to the system at constant volume changes internal energy. Enthalpy, which is represented by symbol H. The total heat content of a system at constant pressure is known as its enthalpy. From first law of thermodynamics, we know that delta U, which is equal to Q plus W. As W, which is equal to minus P into delta V, Q, which is equal to delta U plus P into delta V, and at constant volume, that value delta V, which is equal to zero. So that we have QV, which is equal to delta U. And at constant pressure, we have QP, which is equal to delta U plus P into delta V. The quantity U plus PV is called heat content or enthalpy of the system. And the mathematical expression for enthalpy H, which is equal to U plus PV. And for delta H, which is equal to delta U plus P into delta V. and the enthalpy is a state function and an extensive property. The relationship between heat of reaction at constant pressure and at constant volume. We know that Qp, which is equal to delta H, and Qv, which is equal to delta U. Delta H, which is equal to delta U plus P into delta V, or we can write it as delta U plus P V2 minus V1, which is delta U plus PV2 minus PV1. And putting PV, which is equal to N1RT, and PV2, which is equal to N2RT. So that delta H is equal to delta U plus N2RT minus N1RT. And if you take N2 minus N1 as delta NG, that is change in number of moles with respect to gaseous product to that of gaseous reactant. That is delta H, which is equal to delta U plus delta NG into RT. And QP, which is equal to QV plus delta NRT. Then heat capacity. It is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of a system through 1 degree Celsius. And it is given by C, which is equal to Q divided by delta T, or C, which is equal to dQ by dT. Therefore, Q, which is equal to C into delta T. Two different types of heat capacity. One is specific heat capacity. It is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 gram of a substance through 1 degree Celsius. Q, which is equal to mC into delta T, where m is mass of a sample and C is specific heat. Molar heat capacity. It is the amount of heat required to raise the temperature of 1 mole of a substance through 1 degree Celsius. That is Cm, which is equal to C by N. Heat capacity at constant volume, that is known as Cv. Molar heat capacity at constant volume is defined by the reaction. And heat capacity at constant pressure, Cp. When pressure is maintained at constant, equation 1 takes the form. So, for 1 mole of an ideal gas, heat capacity at constant pressure, that is Cp, is greater than the heat capacity at constant volume, that is Cv. And in general, Cp is greater than Cv, or else Cp, which is equal to Cv plus R. And we have a relationship like heat capacity at constant volume and at constant pressure with respect to R, that is R, which is equal to Cp minus Cv. Types of heat capacities are molar heat capacities. So in the previous slide, I have not given the mathematical expression for heat capacity at constant volume and constant pressure. Here it is. Heat capacity at constant volume, Cv. At constant volume, Qv, which is equal to Cv into delta T, which is equal to delta U. And heat capacity at constant pressure, that is Cp. At constant pressure, Qp, which is equal to Cp into delta T, which is considered as delta H. And here we have a relationship between ratio of Cp to that of Cv and atomicity of a gas. For monoatomic gases, Cp by Cv, which is equal to 1.66. For diatomic gases, Cp by Cv, which is equal to 1.40. For triatomic gases, Cp by Cv, which is equal to 1.33. Then, exothermic and endothermic reactions. So from now, it is chemical thermodynamics. So exothermic reactions are those which are accompanied by evolution of heat. And here delta H is negative for exothermic reaction. Endothermic reactions are those in which heat is absorbed, and delta H is positive for endothermic reaction. There are different types of heats or enthalpies of a reaction. There, enthalpy of combustion, enthalpy of formation, enthalpy of neutralization, enthalpy of solution, heat of hydration, lattice enthalpy and its calculation by using Born-Haber cycle, enthalpy of atomization, bond enthalpy or bond energy, which is also known as bond dissociation enthalpy. So I will explain these processes in the next slides. Then, enthalpy changes during phase transitions. One is heat of sublimation, in which solid state of a compound is converted to gaseous state. Heat of fusion, in which solid state is converted to liquid state. Heat of vaporization, liquid state converted to gaseous state. And here we have Born-Haber cycle for sodium chloride. So we know that sodium present in its solid state, and the solid state of sodium atom is converted to gaseous state. The conversion of solid to gas is known as sublimation. So that here we are using enthalpy of sublimation. Then here we have sodium gas, and we know that sodium is electropositive. So that sodium atom undergoes oxidation to give sodium metal ion. And we know that the amount of energy required to remove the electron, outermost electron from an isolated gaseous atom is known as ionization enthalpy. So that here we are going to use ionization enthalpy. And chlorine. We know that chlorine exists as a gaseous state and in diatomic phase. And that chlorine in diatomic state that has to be converted to monoatomic state. And here the change in the state from diatomic to monoatomic is enthalpy of atomization or enthalpy of dissociation. And chlorine is an electronegative element which has the tendency to accept the electron, or which has the tendency to attract the shared pair of electron towards itself. And the ability to accept an electron is known as electron affinity. Now, we have sodium ion and so chloride ion. And they are combined to form 1 mole of sodium chloride. So, formation of 1 mole of ionic compound from its constituent ions are known is known as lattice enthalpy or lattice energy. And here we have sodium plus half molecules of chlorine, which is going to form sodium chloride. Formation of 1 mole of a compound from the respective constituent atoms are particle is known as enthalpy of formation. So this is the brief explanation of Born-Haber cycle for the formation of sodium chloride. And here we have different types of standard enthalpy changes based on IUPAC recommendation. Enthalpy of formation. 1 mole of the compound formed from its elements. Enthalpy of combustion. 1 mole of the compound is burnt completely in presence of oxygen. Enthalpy of fusion. 1 mole of the liquid is formed from the solid without a change in temperature. Enthalpy of vaporization. 1 mole of the vapor formed from the liquid without a change in temperature. Enthalpy of sublimation. 1 mole of the vapor formed from the solid. Enthalpy of atomization. 1 mole of the substance broken into isolated atoms in the gas phase. Enthalpy of reaction. Enthalpy change taking place in a reaction. Enthalpy of neutralization. 1 mole of water formed by the neutralization of an acid by base. Enthalpy of ionization. 1 mole atoms ionized all species in gaseous phase. Electron gain enthalpy. 1 mole of anion being formed all the species in the gaseous phase. Lattice enthalpy. 1 mole of a crystal completely separated into isolated particles in the gaseous phase. Bond dissociation enthalpy. 1 mole of bond broken all the species in the gaseous phase. Enthalpy of solution. 1 mole of the solute dissolved in excess of solvent so that further dilution produces no enthalpy change. Enthalpy of hydration. 1 mole of the ion in gaseous phase is hydrated. Enthalpy of mixing. 1 mole each of the two or more substance is mixed. Hess law of constant heat summation. It states that the total amount of heat evolved or absorbed in a reaction is the same whether the reaction takes place in one step or in number of steps. So here we can observe A gives rise to B and change in enthalpy is considered as delta H. And this is the general reaction A gives rise to B, but it takes place in different steps. Like first A gives rise to C, which is delta H and delta H1. C gives rise to D, which is known as delta H2, and D gives rise to B, that is known as delta H3. So if you consider delta H, that is A gives rise to B, it's not delta H1, it's delta H. So delta H, that is equal to the sum of delta H1, delta H2 and delta H3. So the total amount of heat absorbed or evolved in a reaction is the same whether that takes place in one step or number of steps. Then entropy, it is a measure of disorderness or randomness of the system. And unit of entropy is joule per Kelvin per mole. And in any process, delta S total, which is equal to delta S system plus delta S surrounding. At equilibrium, entropy of the system is maximum and delta S, which is equal to zero. For irreversible process, delta S total, which is equal to delta S system plus delta S surrounding, which is greater than zero. Second law of thermodynamics. It states that the energy of universe is constant, whereas the entropy of universe is continuously increasing and tends to a maximum. Gibbs free energy and spontaneity. Gibbs energy helps in predicting the spontaneity of a process. It is denoted by G and is given by the formula G, which is equal to H minus TS. The change in Gibbs energy is given by delta G, which is equal to delta H minus T into delta S. Spontaneity in terms of free energy change. If delta G is negative, the process is spontaneous. If delta G is zero, the process does not occur or system is in equilibrium. If delta G, which is equal to positive, then the process does not occur in forward direction. It may occur in backward direction. And at equilibrium, delta G naught, which is equal to delta H naught minus T into delta S naught, and which is also written as minus RT ln K, and in log form, which is equal to minus 2.303 RT log K. Relation between delta G and EMF of a cell. Delta G, which is equal to minus NF E cell, and at standard condition, the same expression is written as delta G naught, which is equal to minus NF E naught cell. Then here the table that shows effect of temperature on spontaneity of reaction. So if delta H and delta H is negative and delta S is positive and delta G is negative, then the process is said to be spontaneous at all temperature. And if delta H and delta S both are negative, then delta G, which is negative at low temperature, and the process is spontaneous at low temperature. And if delta H and delta S are negative and delta G is positive, the process is said to be non-spontaneous at high temperature. And if delta H and delta S and delta G are positive, then the process is said to be non-spontaneous at low temperature. If delta H and delta S are positive and delta G is negative, then the reaction is said to be spontaneous at higher temperature. If both delta H and delta G are positive and delta S are negative, then the process is non-spontaneous at all temperatures. Third law of thermodynamics. At absolute zero temperature, the entropy of a perfectly crystalline substance is taken as zero. And this law was formulated by Nernst in 1906. Laplace-Levoisier law. It states that the total amount of heat evolved or absorbed in a reaction is the same whether the reaction takes place in forward direction or backward direction with opposite sign. So this is the concept map for thermodynamics and thermochemistry. So, students, if this video is helpful, then please like the video and subscribe the channel, and please share it to the maximum. Thank you.